There's a reason that we live so far from Hollywood. In the country, looking hard to find a home. We're nothing perfect or considered, but we're so damn good. It's the story of your life.
Morning, Glory America. Bonjour. Hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt live inside the Beltway on this Tuesday, May 31st, in the year of our Lord 2022. That was the saddest Memorial Day, I think, since Memorial Day 2002 in 20 years. And I'm sure you feel it. I do. I still do. We'll be speaking a lot this week with senators about what, if any, legislative response is appropriate to the horrors of Uvalde and Buffalo and the loss of those 19 children and the two teachers and the victims in the Buffalo supermarket. And it's a discussion that can go off course very, very quickly, but I'll try and have it. Today, Senator Tom Cotton. Tomorrow, Senator Rick Scott. I hope to get John Cornyn, who is the very able leader of the Republican bipartisan working group. I'd like to get Senator Susan Collins, who comes from a state that is very, very friendly to weapons. And also, she is sort of the dead center of the Senate. I got to say on Special Report last night with Mike Emanuel, after Ben Domenech praised the selection of John Cornyn and expressed doubt that anything could happen, I got to say this, cut number 11.
Hugh, what are your expectations as lawmakers get together to discuss a possible path forward?
Well, I want to agree and disagree with Ben, Mike. I think John Cornyn is the perfect person, having served on the state Supreme Court of Texas. I think he also ought to consult with Rick Scott, who is governor of Florida. He's now senator from Florida. Passed legislation in the Sunshine State in the aftermath of the Parkland massacre. But I do think there is a path forward if expectations center on how do we protect innocent children like those in Uvalde against monsters like those that came. And that usually means armed police who are well trained on the campus before the monster arrives. And I think if they follow the model from MAD, back in the days when the drinking age went to 21, federal dollars in exchange for state legislation, those federal dollars for the police on the campuses would, I think, get some states to study seriously the Florida model and others. But I've got to say, President Biden took us all backwards today by bringing 9mm handguns into the discussion, because there is simply no consensus anywhere for denying people the right to own handguns. It doesn't exist.
And so the president sets back everything he touches. I got to say that about the Ukraine issue yesterday. He got asked about weapons for Ukraine. The president did it again, and my comment is cut number 12.
Hugh, what about Ukraine? What is the U.S. interest in Ukraine at this point?
We are interested in helping Ukraine win back its country, and I think the current president ought to take a page from former President Trump, who used to say, I'm not in the business of telling our enemies what I'm going to do or not do. Mm-hmm. Again, a misstep today.
Yeah, yesterday was a series of missteps by the president. Here's his comment on 9mm. I don't understand this. Cut number 5.
I asked him, I said, what's the difference? Why are so many people, not that many more people are being shot? This is not 20 years ago, 25 years. I said, why are they dying? And they showed me a x-ray. He said, a 22 caliber bullet will lodge in the lung, and we can probably get it out, may be able to get it and save the life. A 9mm bullet blows the lung out of the body. So the idea of these high-caliber weapons is that there is simply no rational basis for it in terms of what this is about, self-protection, hunting.
You know, there's an 8-track tape playing in the president's head there, and nobody is talking about banning handguns, 9mm handguns. I believe they represent about 56% of the handguns owned in the United States. I'm not a gun owner, and so I don't know anything about guns. I know a lot about the Second Amendment. I reread Heller yesterday just to be smart in case Mike Emanuel was sitting in for Brett asked me something. The president also talked about, here's his comment on the Ukrainian missiles, cut number 6.
We're not going to send to Ukraine rocket-assisted weapons striking to Russia.
Okay, so really, former President Trump had an all-purpose answer for things either he didn't know the answer to or which he didn't want to discuss, which is I'm not in the habit of telling my enemies what I'm going to do or not do that is actually a useful page that this president might learn from. Other news. Washington Post, U.S. marks Memorial Day weekend with 12 mass shootings. Now, that headline doesn't advance any discussion because a mass shooting, for example, in Chattanooga, where a gunfire erupts between gangs and four people or six people are wounded, is not the sort of mass shooting the United States is worried about. Some people obviously were injured, and it's unfortunate, but people who go to gunfights get in gunfights. People who go to school as fourth graders or shopping at a Buffalo market should have a sense of safety. I'm particularly concerned about schools. Rosaries, bouquets, and tiny caskets. Uvalde begins to bury its dead. Sacred Heart Church, the very Catholic town, is the center of the grieving, and your prayers for those families. I've told you Joe Biden ruled out sending weapons to Ukraine that strike into Russia. By the way, that could be a hand grenade, given that they border each other. It's just the dumbest thing in the world. The West must hold its nerve on Russia. I tweeted this out yesterday. I hope you're following my Twitter feed, because I try and put up there. You'll have to ignore the Browns and Guardians and Cavaliers tweets, but I just try and put stories and good comments. And this is an essay from the Financial Times by Gideon Rockman on how the West has got to hold firm and rearm Ukraine and push back the Russian offensive in the Donbass. They're getting a mile here and a half mile there, but the extraordinary toll on the poor Russian soldier who's been sent there by Putin. Suicide mission for Russian forces ordered to capture Severodonetsk. I don't know I'm saying anything Ukrainian correctly, but the Telegraph this morning talks about the inch-by-inch attempt to take more of the Donbass. For whatever reason, we don't know. Russia felt obliged, according to the Telegraph, to put out a statement yesterday that Vladimir Putin is healthy. No, he's not. Man is nuts. The Germans are turning on their failing leaders, according to the Telegraph. Good. They've completely welched on their deal. And the Germans understand that Scholz is a disaster. They want a do-over in their election. Russian forces push into pivotal city in eastern Ukraine. The fighting in the Donbass, again, just mile by mile. The government of Israel tells 100 Israelis in Turkey to leave as the Iranians threat to their safety has grown, intelligence tells us. Oil has breached $120 a barrel. It's going to go higher as China reopens. That's the oil prices hit two-month high, says the Wall Street Journal, as China eases lockdowns. A senior Fed official has called for higher rates that start to stunt the U.S. economy. Yesterday, by the way, Great Britain released its year-over-year inflation, 8.7% in Great Britain. That is really extraordinary. The Mona Lisa was attacked by a nut yesterday. What is it with a 37-year-old man who pretends to be a granny in a wheelchair to throw a pie at the Mona Lisa? What's the difference between that person and someone who defaces the Mona Lisa? He might have. He didn't know there was glass there. It's just a stunt. I'm all for 5 years in jail for stunts. No more slaps on the wrist. Because stunts require police, and that means police can't be where monsters come. So stunt people enable monsters. Do you understand? Stunt people enable monsters by spreading police thin. Top Gun Maverick grabs a Memorial Day weekend box office record, $156 million in the United States. Bravo. I'll tell you now that my son-in-law is one of the pilots in the movie, and they had a blast supporting the production of that off the Teddy Roosevelt. Many years ago now, many, many years ago, and they had a blast, and we had a blast watching it and knowing a little bit of the inside story. By the way, Tom Cruise was very professional working with the pilots and their crews and the carrier crew and everybody else. All I heard was that was a very professional operation on both sides. It's funny, though, when you see Tom Cruise as an actor playing a real pilot, when you know real fighter pilots and the people who support them, and you realize that pretend is pretend and real is real, and people who have 700 landings on a carrier are different from you and me. There's a headline I want to go at length on at some point. I don't know if I have time. Summer worker shortage means things will be closed again. Pools, restaurants, and camps cut operation even though demand is back. You know, it will take one announcement from Harvard and Yale or the College Admissions Council that 40-hour work between your sophomore and junior year and your junior and senior year will be counted as very vital to understanding whether or not you will work hard enough to succeed in college. I'll ask Larry Arnn about that this week. I really do think that colleges ought to say, we expect you to work. Because if you can't work during the summer, if you're lying around on the internet, you know, texting on 4chan with your goofball friends, one of whom turns into a monster, then you're not going to be a good college student. We don't want you. That all those jobs would get filled. Finally, Egypt has unearthed a trove of artifacts, 250 mummies and crucially, intact papyrus, sealed from 500 years before the birth of Christ. Another Book of the Dead beckons. It's really fascinating in the Washington Post. I'll be right back. My number is 1-800-520-1234. What do you want the bipartisan working group to accomplish in the Senate? I'm Hugh Hewitt. Tell me what you think. Welcome back, America. I am Hugh Hewitt. Thank you for listening today. The market report on this Tuesday morning after Memorial Day is brought to you by Birch Gold. If you're buying gold today, and some of you are looking at the price of gold at $1,855 an ounce and saying, you know, inflation's going to take that to $2,000 and beyond, I'm going to buy some gold, do it at HughGold.com or text my name Hugh to 989898. That's pretty easy to remember, H-U-G-H to 989898. Or if you can't remember that, Hugh Gold, that's eight letters for you Steelers fans, HughGold.com. And they will send you the information kit on opening an IRA that is precious metals depository. It is administered by Birch Gold. The IRS recognized them as a legitimate administering agent. You can't do it on your own. You have to have a third party administer a physical metals IRA. And that's the group to use. That's the group I recommend. If you're buying gold, I recommend you do it from them as well. HughGold.com or text H-U-G-H to 989898. The markets are mixed in Europe this morning. Friday doesn't matter. Friday is like a million years ago when it was a great day on the market. The Dow went up 575 points on Friday. The Nasdaq up 390. Too early to say what the markets will do today, although they have to absorb the impact of oil, both West Texas and Brent crude at just under $120 a barrel as demand is going to go off the roof. And inflation, you know, President Biden won't do anything to increase oil production. So, of course, we're not using the Defense Industrial Act to increase oil production. I don't know why. And as a result, we're all going to pay more. The 10-year Treasury, though, did dip down to 2.743 as bonds held by Americans. That's good for people buying real estate. But gold and real estate, that's what you want to be in during an inflationary period such as is in front of us. Birch Gold at HughGold.com. I'm going to talk about what do you want the Senate working group, if anything, to do. Stacy in Houston. Good morning, Stacy.
Hey, good morning, Professor Hewitt. Hey, I want to preface my quick comment by saying, you know, notice how we keep propping the system up, the educational system up. No matter what happens, we just keep moving forward. Okay, so remember, COVID first happened. Schools got shut down. Parents were home as well. That was a great opportunity to take a look at both of those things and come up with one solution that would solve both of them. We didn't do it. I won't go into what it is, but if you just think about it deeply, there was an opportunity to redo education as well as housing. So,
well, Stacy, I agree with that, and I actually don't agree, though. I think a lot of people have taken the opportunity to reassess their education plans, but you are right about the fact that COVID opened a lot of eyes, and Uvalde are going to open more eyes to the fact that this vast bureaucratic education system does not work, even at the most basic level of the physical protection of innocent children who are defenseless.
So moving forward, so then what we did was over the next few couple of years, because we were a couple of years into COVID and schools and the whole situation there, we just went back to normal, you know. And actually, when it first happened, if you go back and listen to what teachers were saying, they were telling parents, oh, we know it's difficult, and oh, we'll help you through it, and let's do the best we can, instead of us just completely rethinking the whole system. Okay. And I'm really talking about choice.
Sure. Okay. I gathered that. Yeah.
Right.
You have one.
Okay.
You got 1 minute left, Stacy.
Okay. Here's the comment. We have to really get back to this choice thing. And we really have to think about it, and not for those parents who have the resources to force choice, you know, into their lives, but for the masses that really don't have the opportunity.
I think that is coming, Stacy. I have talked to, I've talked to 100 people in public life who agree the time is now to end the education monopoly. And I think you should be an optimist. You are not alone. There are local groups in Houston that are working on school choice. There are national scholars at AEI that are working on school choice. And I believe that the charter schools coming out of Hillsdale are going to advance across the country like never before, because the education system is broken, and we will fix it. Stay tuned, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
is me, and not from the same slice is me. Where do we go from here, my friend? Is this the way our story?
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Now, America is a violent place, but I don't think it's necessarily more violent than any other place similarly populated and similarly diverse and similarly conflicted. I'm sure it's less violent than Canada, but there aren't as many people in Canada. I'm sure it's less violent than Norway, but there aren't that many people in Norway. You go to Brazil, you go to India, you go to China, where they got a million people. That's violence to put a million people in concentration camps. There aren't as many guns in Japan, but there's violence. So we have guns, and so the issue is what to do about it. And I don't think people who come with easy answers are to be listened to. My question to the audience is, what would you like to see the bipartisan working group discuss this week? By the way, one answer to violence is to make sure that people who come out of prison are rehabilitated. That's what Prison Fellowship does. That's what the Prison Fellowship Academy does. There's a web banner at hughhewitt.com, which will tell you about the Prison Fellowship Academy. It's a wonderful thing. Michael Vanderhorst was on the show last week. Here he tells you a little bit about what that academy accomplished.
We're creating a new program, which actually is, how do we engage people when that academy journey is done? They're like done with that year-long process, and they're still going to be inside or maybe go home. How do we stay connected and continue that journey? So I've been able to actually take on a career that takes all my past and gives it a real strong, defined purpose, which... It's amazing.
If you want to drain violence from the society, you invest in organizations like Prison Fellowship Academy, and they're not asking for money, by the way. Not a fundraiser. They'd like you to learn about the program. The banner is at hughhewitt.com. Bill in Houston, what would you like to see the Senate working group accomplish?
Well, I'd like to see my dad retire at NYPD 23 years before the RICO statute became law with five mafia families. So I had quite a little experience with what was going on. And after 9/11, they had Marines in LaGuardia Airport. And that's what you, like you were saying, about to have the people there before they come in. Or when they see fire, and the other thing is make sure they have superior firepower. Because during the time when my dad was before the RICO statute, the criminals were better equipped to handle it, and the police didn't have this firepower to be able to handle it. So we're going to have superior firepower. Go ahead.
Yeah, well, I personally would like to see them explore how much would it cost to have two armed police officers, and I'm not going to call them school resource officers anymore. That's Orwellian. I want police officers on the campuses of K-12, public and private, but there are 131,000 such campuses. One police officer isn't enough, and they need more than their ordinary weapon, but they don't have to carry it with them. Although I must say, when I go to Israel and I see all these 18-year-olds running around with their AK-47s or their Uzis, it doesn't bother me. They've been trained. And they've been screened. And so I don't think, and I was in France a month ago, and there were gendarmes everywhere with automatic weapons. And I mean semi-automatic. I mean the real deal weapons of war. And nobody cares because they're afraid of terrorist attacks there, and they have to be on guard. So I just think we should be realistic about if the problem is protecting innocent children at school, you put armed force in the way of monsters.
Yeah, and another thing is that I know a lot of police officers. My father-in-law was a youth police officer killed in the line of duty back in 1968, so I've got to know a lot of the police officers here. A lot of them retired. They went into campuses, and these guys are trained. The same thing with the military. These guys are trained, and you can, I'm not going to put some of the people that they have, but some of the people are not that qualified to be.
Thank you, Bill. I agree. That's why I don't think the arm. I appreciate the call. I don't want retirees. I heard from an officer last week that the best person to put on a school campus is someone who is serving with a police force for 5 years. Now, God knows the incident commander, who was the police chief of a 6-member school district police force, has got enough grief and regret to last a lifetime, as do every officer that was there, as does the teacher who left open the door. I know all about that. I do know, however, that 6-person police departments are going to attract a Barney Fife or two, and that there shouldn't be 6-person police departments. I'd like to go back. I haven't seen anyone write yet. Why is there a separate school district police force for Uvalde? And you ought to ask, why is there a Metropolitan Transit Authority police? I know that. They have specific duties that are relevant in the Washington metropolitan area to Reagan and Dulles and the subway system. And there's a transit police in New York. I do not understand why a school district would have a separate police system anywhere at any time. Because they don't have... You can have school people devoted to discipline, but they're not police. NYPD ought to patrol New York police schools. And I was persuaded by an officer last week. It ought to be people 5 years into their career who are, you know, have done patrol. They're smart. They're young. They're trained. And they get a two-year assignment, and they serve at more than one school in rotation to become acquainted. And you have two at every campus. I'm persuaded by that. Stephen in South Carolina. Good morning, Stephen.
Mr. Hewitt, it's always an honor to talk to you, sir.
Thank you.
You've helped me through some hard times. I found you last February. I've had the honor of talking to you about three or four times. I don't have any children. I have a nine-year-old niece. I told my sister, Catholic school. Notice that none of the shootings have happened in Catholic, in private schools especially. What does that tell you? And if I have one more comment after that.
Well, what that tells me is that monsters are less aware of private schools, but I just knocked on wood. I'm very aware of that. I also know that my local Catholic school is very secure, but my Catholic schools of my youth were not. I mean, people wandered in and out of the building. I just don't know that they're equipped, but I do believe that they could be targets in the future. I don't think God protects them.
Right. It's weird that since Columbine, all these school shootings have happened in public schools. One more comment, if I may.
Okay, can I give you one other suggestion? The monsters who target public schools come out of public schools, and their anger is directed at classmates and a culture that rejected them, or at least they have told themselves rejected them, when in fact their family and their whole circumstance creates the monster. But their vengeance, I haven't seen this authenticated yet, but the high school that rejected the monster in Texas went through a tradition of visiting Rob Elementary School the day before his attack.
Right,
I think
right.
There's a connection there.
You're probably right. One more thing. The Republicans, I think, why not put pressure on... There's no wiggle room in this country. That's why we're doomed. That's why we're not going to make it out of the century. There's no more center. Let's have an agreement. Let's make a deal. 21 years old, across the board.
Okay, now I actually think there is a center. It's interesting that the 21-year-old thing was part of Rick Scott's package of reforms in Florida when he was governor, and he's going to be on tomorrow, and I'm going to ask him about that. It was very controversial. Some gun people, some gun rights advocates express, if you can vote, why can't you own a gun? And the answer is, well, maybe they shouldn't vote.
Would you be in? That's the next point. Why not? 20-year-olds don't have. Should not be canceling out my 44-year-old vote. Let's do it.
Well, I'll tell you what. It's very
until you're 21.
You can pass that law.
You're 21. Can't.
You can't pass that law.
21. Can't vote till you're 21. Why not?
You'd have
Let's make a deal.
You have to amend the Constitution to change the voting age. You do not have to amend the Constitution to put in a 21-year-old.
But the Republicans can't be always the ones moving closer to the center. The Democrats
I agree. That is well said, because it's very, very aggravating for the president to destroy the effort by casually mumbling out something about 9mm handguns, which no American, if 20% of America believes in amending the Constitution to confiscate 9mm handguns, then that 20% can try, if they want, to amend the Constitution. That's unconstitutional. And so the president mumbling about that and lungs and bullets, he's just not up to this task. And so we need the Senate to lead. Stephen, thank you. I want to get one more in. John in Washington, D.C. John?
Good morning. How are you?
Good.
I would like to propose something like an NTSB on all gun violence. And what I'm trying to get at is that a lot of these mass shootings has been thwarted. And, you know, it gets reported and the police report and they recover. And so the question is is there a central authority that examines what stopped them?
Yes, the FBI does do that. And in fact, Matt Vespa, if you Google Matt Vespa, three words that work, he wrote a very comprehensive summary of the four incidents since 2018 where would-be school massacres were stopped in parking lots or at doors by police officers with an armed response.
Then the question is, why aren't there standards then that come out of it? Like the
NTSB
will publish standards.
That is the question.
All schools, I mean, it's one thing, physical barriers are physical barriers. I mean, we can go into a D.C. public schools, and you just cannot walk into a D.C. public school
with. John, you're right. And I think the obvious answer is two armed police officers at every campus. I think that's the answer. What do you want in return for the funding for that? And I expect that Democrats will ask for, and perhaps the Republicans will agree, to a red flag law that has serious due process protections and may only be initiated by the police, not by a family member. Go ahead.
I would like to see probably private insurance companies and everybody else get involved because they get affected by people that are killed and, you know, civilians and stuff like that. So they probably have their ideas, too. It doesn't necessarily have to come from the public sector.
No, I just, the people that are running point here will be a small group of United States senators. The Republicans will be led by John Cornyn. I hope the senator joins me this week. I hope Senator Tom Cotton will be on a little bit later. I'll ask him who's in the group. And I'd like to talk to Senator Collins this week, Senator Portman this week. I will talk to Senator Scott tomorrow. They are all across the ideological line of the Republicans. It does not help anybody to have an extreme point of view articulated. Nothing can be done. Everything should be done. What helps is for callers like you and our earlier callers and more coming up to express themselves quietly and persuasively. Thanks, John. Bill in Pennsylvania, got like 30 seconds. Sorry, buddy, but I want to get you in before David Drucker joins us.
Yeah, I think I'm a gun owner myself, but I think the age to own semi-automatics should be raised to 25. Anything under that, only single-shot, small-caliber arms. And we got to harden the schools. That's just a given. I don't know what the problem is. People can't break into prisons and shoot them up. I don't know why they could break into schools and shoot them up. That should just be a given. But
It's expensive, but you're right. That is the way forward, Bill. Offer the money for that in exchange for whatever they agree is a necessary state-level law. The federal law won't. This is a federalism issue. This should be done state by state because there are different cultures about weapons in each. Thank you, Bill. It's Relief Factor Tom time. Time for the ongoing saga of Hugh's hip. It got worse this weekend. My California doctor is worried about thrombosis. I'm not. I'm worried about bone bruises and how long they last because I'm limping around like Festus. And back to tour day. Nature has anti-inflammatories. Icarin, curcumin, resveratrol, and omega. In combination, done well by ReliefFactor.com. I can't take a leave. I can't take any NSAID. Haven't been able to do for since 1985. And so, long story, you don't need to know why. But I can't take them. So all I get is Tylenol, or sometimes Tylenol 3, and usually Advil, and ReliefFactor.com. And I need it right now, because I'm walking like Festus. I did not do my typical walk to Arlington. I just can't. I didn't go anywhere this weekend. But ReliefFactor.com worked, so I'm doubled down, and it's helping. But it's going to be a ways back, I think. And if you're like me, try ReliefFactor.com. David Drucker is next. Stay tuned. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. David M. Drucker covers the Beltway like no one else for the Washington Examiner. Follow him on Twitter at David M. Drucker. David, Senator Cornyn will be leading the Republican effort to respond, if a response is actually possible from the federal level, to the massacre in Uvalde and Buffalo. Who else is on that working group? Do you know?
Well, I think, you know, the question is who's going to become consequential in that working group. I mean, obviously, Senator Pat Toomey, in years past, has tried to find a way to pass legislation dealing with gun safety or how you improve gun safety without chipping away at gun rights that are enshrined in the Constitution. So I think the Cornyn position in this working group is important because his Second Amendment bona fides are strong, and he's got a really good relationship with Mitch McConnell. And so obviously I left out he's a senator from Texas. But the fact that he's a former number two in the Republican Senate hierarchy and may want to be in leadership again, and that him and McConnell are tight, I think, is what makes him one to watch here.
I also want to add, he was on the Texas State Supreme Court, so he's a jurist of accomplishment who understands the Constitution and constitutional rights and federalism. But I've named the guests I asked for this week. I've got Senator Cotton coming up. Said I'd like Senator Cornyn. I want Senator Collins, who comes from a gun state but is a moderate. My Maine is a very gun-friendly state. And, of course, Senator Rick Scott, who is Governor Scott, oversaw the legislation in response to Parkland that was widely regarded as breakthrough. Those are the big four, in my view. And I'd also like to talk to Rob Portman because Ohio is a mixed state. That means that there are many gun control advocates and many gun ownership advocates in Ohio. It's like the rest of the country split.
Yeah, and I think Senator Rick Scott is watching him is, I think, smart on your part in that when he was governor of Florida, he signed legislation that was not necessarily, the legislation he signed in his state, and he was a big part of putting that legislation together, was not, voters in Florida responded well to it. Not all gun rights activists were pleased with it, but he was willing to sign it because he thought it was a proper response to what happened in Parkland. Obviously, Democrats thought he should have gone further, but that makes his thoughts on any emerging legislation here extremely interesting.
Yeah, the 10% on either extreme, amend the Constitution and confiscate guns or leave my guns alone completely. I want to be able to buy automatic weapons. They are loud. They take up bandwidth. They do not represent the 80%. And I think Rick Scott saw past that. I'm curious now, I've named the Republicans. Who on the Democratic side will acknowledge that the Second Amendment is an individual right that has teeth and cannot be unrestricted absent a compelling reason and narrowly drawn provisions?
Well, I think we have to look at where Democrats have been on the past on this if we're trying to figure out where they might be this time around. I mean, obviously Senator John Tester of Montana, a Democrat who has always been very sensitive to gun rights because of his state, and Senator Joe Manchin of West Virginia for all the obvious reasons. You know, even Senator Chris Murphy from Connecticut, who's always the Democrat at the center of these things, these negotiations since Sandy Hook, seems to have exhibited a good understanding of where Republicans are on this and what the constitutional limitations are. And, you know, I think a lot of people ask questions such as, well, why can't we just get rid of automatic weapons? But, of course, you know, there are a lot of weapons that are technically semi-automatic weapons, but that are not, you know, the Gatling guns that people think of when they think of, why can't we just get rid of automatic weapons? And he seems to be pretty well versed in these things. So even though his opinions may be to the left of someone like Tester or Manchin, I pay attention to him because he seems to understand the issue from a mechanical sense.
And, well, I think Senator Murphy can. I think he can move a conversation along because if he agrees with something, that means it's an 80% issue.
Yeah. Yeah, the key here is, Hugh, is you know, as you know, but as I've covered these things over the years, gun rights, and I don't know if Democrats totally understand this, but gun rights is such a determinative issue in terms of how you vote, at least in federal elections, for Republicans. And even though Democrats feel strongly about this, Democratic voters, it's not a determinative issue in the same way it is for Republicans. And it's that feeling among Republican voters that actually pushes what happens in Washington versus the other way around. And I just don't think Democrats understand that.
Well, the approach to a federal solution is also, I think, a sine non qua here. If there is no federal statute coming out, but there is a possibility of a federal carrot and stick approach. David M. Drucker, I'll be reading you very closely this week. Nobody knows the Senate like David Drucker. I really mean that. Like, nobody knows the Senate like David Drucker. And so follow what he has to write. Follow him on Twitter. Follow me to next hour. His colleague Byron York comes along. Senator Tom Cotton later in the show. I'm interested in your phone calls. What would you like to see this bipartisan working group produce, if anything? 1-800-520-1234. Connection to the Hugh Hewitt Show. Morning, Glory America. Bonjour. Hi, Canada. On this Monday, May 31st, in the year of our Lord, 2022. I'm talking all week about what you would like to see a Senate bipartisan working group propose for the Senate to initiate, if anything. And I'm beginning the conversation this hour with Byron York of the Washington Examiner. You see him on Fox News. He is also, of course, prolific on Twitter and is very sober and very aware of the remarkable convergence of issues and emotions. Good morning, Byron. One of the saddest Memorial Days in memory, marked by a lot of people talking quietly as opposed to shouting about what, if anything, can be done to prevent monsters invading the classrooms of fourth graders. What do you hear?
Well, I think the thing that's striking about what's being said on Capitol Hill is how modest the proposals are at the moment. It's like we've had an incredible shrinking gun control debate. If you listen to Senator Chris Murphy, he's the Democrat from Connecticut, who's kind of taking the lead in this. He's not talking about an assault weapons ban. He's not talking about universal background checks. He's saying maybe we can do something smaller. And I think that is behind Mitch McConnell deputizing Senator Cornyn to be in talks about this. I think they're going to look for something that would be smaller, might make some improvement around the edges, but won't at all address what happened in Uvalde or what happened in Buffalo before that.
Byron, back in, you may be too young to remember when Mothers Against Drunk Driving successfully pressured the Congress to do carrot and stick, meaning we are not allowing you access to federal highway funds until you raise the drinking age to 21. So to me, the approach that has to be put on the table is money for school protection. And I mean armed police. I'm not going to use school resource officer Orwellian speak anymore. Armed police at schools, and that's expensive. There are 131,000 K-12 public and private schools, and I think they each need two police officers. If you don't want to have this happen again, they've got to be there and not like the school resource officer in Uvalde off having a coffee somewhere. They have to be on the campus before children arrive until children leave. That's a $45 billion using TSA extrapolation, TSA budget. That's $45 billion a year. I don't know if that's doable, but I certainly wouldn't try and legislate for every state because every state has a different culture when it comes to weapons and self-protection for reasons largely related to geography and the fact that even in Uvalde, it took 7 minutes from a 911 call for an officer to arrive.
Well, this is where the sort of laboratories of democracy come into effect. We've been hearing that New York, New Jersey, and California are going to do something. You know, I think one thing that's kind of instructive is that Florida, after the Parkland shooting in 2018, did enact a gun measure. Republican legislature with a Republican governor, Governor Rick Scott, now the senator from Florida, signed it. And I believe it raised the age to 21.
It did.
It imposed sort of a red flag law, although we should say that New York has a red flag law.
It does.
It did not stop the Buffalo shooting. So states are freer. I mean, there is the right to bear arms is an enumerated right in the Constitution, so they can only go so far. But states are freer to enact some controls, and I agree with you. I don't see why we shouldn't have those enacted. And if some of them are particularly effective, perhaps they could be enacted on a national basis.
I went back and read the seminal Heller decision penned by Justice Scalia, in which he noted, yep, nothing in our opinion should be taken to cast doubt on longstanding prohibitions on the possession of firearms by felons and the mentally ill, or laws forbidding the carrying of firearms in sensitive places such as schools and government buildings, or laws imposing conditions and qualifications on the commercial sale of arms. And so Heller established the individual right, but like the First Amendment rights, they are not absolute. And it's, by the way, it's a talking point to say they're not absolute. We know that. The question is, how best, I think, Byron, you can't stop Buffalo. All right, you have to find those people, but you can stop Uvalde. That's Hugh Hewitt's view. I don't know if it's widely shared. I think you can have armed police 24/7 during school on every campus in America, two of them. And I think they can stop this. And I believe they have secondary effects, network effects, which are very good throughout the community, and they're worth the money. But do you agree with me?
Well, I think the thing that has been really stunning to people about Uvalde has been the failure not only of the, quote, school resource officer, but of the actual police who show up and then do not go into the school. And they wait and they wait, and then there are some Border Patrol agents who finally lead them in. And we don't know exactly if lives could have been saved if they had gone in immediately.
Byron, I have a question, a reporter's question. The school district had its own police department. The incident commander was the chief of the six-person police department. Someone needs to go back and find out, and maybe you know, why did they have their own police department? Because if that's not an invitation to Barney Fife, I don't know what is. The idea that he was the incident commander is appalling to me. And I, as a parent or a family member of a victim, I would be so outraged. And I would go back and find out, why did a school district establish a separate police force? That is crazy. Because
that is an excellent question. And no, it's an excellent question. We should have an answer to that. But I think the fact that they did make these nods towards school security indicates that what you're saying about a two-person police presence at every school is what you're trying to say is, this time we need to do it right.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. It can be done right.
Because doing it it failed in Uvalde.
Matt Vespa, by the way, had an article last week in Town Hall about the four occasions in 2018 and 2021, three in 2018, one in 2021, where police officers stopped would-be mass murderers in parking lots or at doors. So it has worked.
Yeah, yeah. And as far as Buffalo is concerned, I do agree with you to some extent. I mean, you have a guy who's writing a manifesto which says what he's going to do, and it I don't know if you've read it. I have not.
Sort of.
It discusses in inordinate length the relative advantages of this helmet versus that helmet, of this vest versus that vest. And he makes several points where he's got to do this because he's hiding it from his parents, who I don't think had any reason to know what was going on. But this guy is posting this stuff in a very obscure part of the internet. I'm not sure how we address that.
Key interesting fact here. At my conservatives at Mark Zuckerberg dinner, I asked Mark if there was the potential with artificial intelligence to identify Columbine killers. And he said, no, there's not. So it's not on the table. But if there was, would we even want them to use it? Byron.
No, I think we'd feel very uncomfortable.
Yes, exactly.
With that level of surveillance. On the other hand, this is not the first shooting that we've had in which we go back and we find a guy who's been posting posts that say, I'm going to kill somebody.
Yeah, the monsters of the Fortnite both did that. Both of
it's
them
very
did
very frustrating
that.
Afterwards to see that. And you think, well, what... Isn't there some way sort of to pick that up? But usually it's done by what they call human intelligence. Somebody hears him. He says something to somebody, and they report it to police. That's the old-fashioned way of finding out if somebody is kind of a ticking time bomb. But it makes it very, very – because he went to some lengths to conceal what he was doing, and it makes it very difficult. You know, there are some of these measures that I don't have – a particular problem with based on what you read, the passage you read from Heller, which is the age of 21 thing I don't have a problem with, although there has been a case in the Fourth Circuit, hasn't there?
Familiar with it.
I was kind of struck by it. It basically struck down an age of 21 requirement. So I don't know where that would go legally, but I don't have any problem with that. certainly red flag laws if they include enough due process. But if they include due process, they'll be slow. So there are some things that can be done, but all of this stuff is just around the edges.
Yeah, the problem is the monster, right? Where do they come from? How do you find them? How do you stop them before they kill? And how do you ever know that you successfully stopped a monster from killing? You can't. But Byron York, you'll be on the case. I'll be reading everything you write about it in your morning newsletter and on Fox. I'll be watching. Follow him on Twitter at Byron York. Come right back. More on the Hugh Hewitt Show ahead. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Your phone calls are coming up shortly. Senator Tom Cotton joins me next hour. This week, I'm going to talk about where the Senate should go on guns, if anywhere, and on school protection via police funding provided by the federal government supplementing police departments, and for what and under what conditions. Let me remind you, our sponsor, VanderandTodd.com, there with Sierra Pacific Mortgage. I really want to hit this hard because I talked to my son-in-law this weekend about it, who was thinking about a larger house. He now has four children. And I said, well, look, interest rates are going up, so if you're going to do this, go quick. And the interesting thing, and call Andrew and Todd, because he's active duty military, so he has one loan out, and you can only do one loan at a time, and you don't want to sell the house that he has a great loan on. I said, go to andrewandtodd.com, find out. The 10-year treasury this morning is at 2.743. That's the lowest it's been in about a month. And that's because money's pouring into the United States. That's a momentary blip in rates that might have brought them back into the 4%. And I would urge anyone who's going to buy a house, whether it's your primary residence, a rental, a second home, do it now. Call Andrew and Todd at 888-888-1172, 888-888-1172. That rate cannot hold. That 10-year treasury cannot hold as the Fed moves aggressively to kill off inflation, which was at 8.7% on an annual basis in the United Kingdom. Over the weekend, that number came out. And so we are at 8.3. We're going to go higher. And we're going to have a recession. And until that recession crushes economic activity like recessions do, and when the economy retracts, the interest rates will not fall again. So you are on a rising tide of interest rates, which if you've got to refinance to get money out, you got to rush. If you're going to buy a house or a second home or an investment property, you have to rush. The good news is AndrewandTodd.com are equipped to handle it. I've talked to Andrew every time I've been in California, and sometimes Todd. They're old friends. They're competent. I know their team. 888-888-1172. Melvin in Ohio, what do you think, Melvin?
Hi, I was calling regarding your dinner with Mark Zuckerberg when you were saying that they don't have the ability to notice certain words.
He didn't say that. I said, can you identify mass murderers before they act? And he said, no, we can't.
Oh, so I think they should be able to identify people that are saying they're going to go shoot someone. You know, there's certain threats like that that should be identified.
Well, I asked a very simple question. He said, someone at the table, not Zuckerberg, said, you're talking about Minority Report. And I said, no, I'm really talking about a specific kind of threat. And, of course, artificial intelligence has advanced dramatically in the 3 years since that dinner, and maybe AI can do it. There's a question about whether or not we want to do it, Melvin. That's a very powerful weapon to ask anyone to wield, right?
Correct. But that would also just take culture or society to say that, okay, certain things you can say, certain things are not jokes. Just like we've learned to speak in certain tones, that would just be a learning curve. But I think it's worth it. If you ask the parents in Uvalde, they'll say it was well worth it.
I agree with you. I don't understand the monster in Uvalde told people, and they knew he was a monster, that he was going to do something. They've recreated the 4chan chat. He asked his sister to buy him a gun, and the sister didn't call police. Now, I've known mentally ill people. I'm sure you have as well. If they ever ask me to buy him a gun, the next call is to their parents or their loved one, and the next call is to the police. I don't understand it. I do not understand. But I wasn't 18 either, or 16 or 15. Gamers, I don't know the world. I'm 66. I don't know that world.
You're right, and there are so many codes we would have, so many things that we would layer and have to understand. But there's something, we have to do something to make a difference. I'm just blessed that my daughter's out of grade school, but she's teaching at school now. She's a professor, and that could be just as horrifying for me. You know, we have to figure something out.
Yeah, you know, I'm invested. I have two new grandkids within the last 10 days, cousins. I don't want them to grow up in this world. I didn't grow up in this world. My kids generally didn't grow up in this world. I don't want my grandchildren to grow up in this world, even if it's every 10 years. And if anyone ever tells me that, they're going to cut off. Hey, thank you, Melvin in Ohio. More coming up, 1-800-520-1234. No, it's just, the unacceptable has arrived, and it's unacceptable. Unacceptable. I'll be right back. It's Hugh Hewitt.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Prison Fellowship Academy.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, talking with people about what they would like to see, if anything, the Senate working group led on the Republican side by Senator John Cornyn. I do not know who has been designated by Senator Schumer to represent Democrats ought to come up with. Richard in Tampa, Florida. Richard, what do you think?
Hey, Hugh.
Good morning.
I think that part of the problem is that when these guys are pulling up to these school shootings, they don't have the safety gear that they need, so they're having to wait. So my suggestion is why don't they stage safety gear at the schools, shields, body armor, helmets, so that when the police officers do pull up, all the gear is available to them right there, and they can be a little more aggressive.
Boy, that's smart. That's very smart. That's very smart.
Well, I've been trying to call some people because I thought it was a really good idea.
It is. That's why I'm doing this week. It's like the police officer from Columbus last week who called me and said, you don't want retired cops and you don't want rookies. You want police at schools who have been there in the force for 5 years, who are still young and agile, but trained and professional and vetted, and you want them to rotate through all the schools in the district. From many people come some ideas that will persuade many people, and I think yours is a very good one. Thank you, Richard. That's smart. Candace, California. Hi, Candace.
Good morning, you.
Good morning. You're on, Candace.
Thanks. In the wake of the shooting, California is actually making it easier for school shooters because they just introduced a bill. I believe it's SB 1274, where the schools will no longer have the ability to report violent threats to the police.
You see, that some nutter introduced that, and that won't pass.
Senator Stephen Bradford introduced that.
Yeah, that won't pass.
I hope not.
No, I mean, that's just nuts. Is he a left-wing nut or is he a right-wing nut?
I don't know.
I don't know either. That's just stupid. And you know, I've kind of had it with just stupid people. Because I get, you know, poor Jacob, he has to deal with just stupid people every day who want to call up and haven't read Heller and want to tell me that you can't restrict weapons to felons and mentally ill and you can't have age limits. Well, Heller, you can't restrict. I'm not saying any particular law. I just know what Heller says, and Heller says nothing. I want to read it again. And to all the dumb people out there, nothing in our opinion should be taken to cast doubt on longstanding prohibitions on the possession of firearms by felons and the mentally ill, or laws forbidding the carrying of firearms in sensitive places such as schools and government buildings, or laws imposing conditions and qualifications on the commercial sale of arms. All right, that the Constitution protects an individual right to own and bear arms primarily for private protection, also in support of a militia should one ever be necessary, but primarily for personal protection. And it's got nothing to do with hunting and providing for your, it's got everything to do with personal protection. And the 7 minutes between the 911 call after shots were fired at Uvalde and the arrival of the first officer is all the argument anyone needs. 7 minutes is why people own guns. I don't, but some do. Thank you. Henry in Cleveland. Good morning, Henry. Guardians won yesterday. That was the only really bright spot in a dark weekend. Good morning, Henry. You're on.
Okay. If they can identify sexual predators and monitor that line or whatever, why can't they do that with the same?
Well, that's a great question. Can I give you a little bit of an answer? Sexual predators trade in images. And so child pornography leaves an evidentiary trail that is absolute and can be prosecuted. Words are not that. And usually words such as the words I've seen the monster in Uvalde use are not dispositive in the way that trading an image is dispositive. One of my favorite words is dispositive, meaning conclusory, meaning it, you know, that's over. You trade an image of a child in child intimate position, in sexual positions, you have broken the law and you're going to jail. You make a vague threat, no, you haven't. You've just raised a red flag that can be noticed but not prosecuted.
But if they can do that with with the right wing groups, they were able to identify, and take them off. Or if you're right wing or right thinking, I can't think, it's to the right. If they can do that and take you off and identify those things, why can't they just do that with, my initial question.
I'll go back. I'm not sure I want artificial intelligence. I'm open to conversation. I'm not saying no. I asked Zuckerberg this, and I'll ask Peter Thiel this. I'll ask Blake Masters in Arizona. I'll ask people who understand it. Do we have the technology to identify with precision people who represent an actual threat? I do not want people who are bandying about terms that the left woke police don't like, such as an armed citizenry is a guarantee of freedom. I don't want those people to raise red flags. That's just that's a phrase that is in common parlance among people who are Second Amendment enthusiasts and concerned about erosion of constitutional rights. So the problem, of course, is the left taking a good idea and turning it into a bad idea by expanding it to cover citizens exercising rights as opposed to nutters and monsters preparing to kill. That's the problem.
Unfortunately, if I may add, if they have these manifestos and they have identified them, they go back and look at them, why can't they come up with a program when that person puts up a manifesto that he's going to kill whatever?
Yeah, that I agree with you. I do not know how the Buffalo shooter eluded police or, and let me speak to the broader public. If you see something, say something about manifestos. And I don't care if it comes from a white supremacist or an Islamist killer. I don't come from a mentally unbalanced person. If you see something, say something. You're not ratting. I'm not talking about ordinary conversation among people of left or right about what they believe to be we the people of the United States in order to guarantee a more perfect union. I'm not talking about constitutional discussion. I'm talking about just straight out crazy. And straight out crazy isn't hard to find. What's interesting is we have a list in the studio. Can I tell you this, Henry? We have a list in the studio. Generalissimo, how long is our list of people who are not allowed on the air now after 23 years? Generalissimo asleep. We're trying to get the minicam to work.
To get the next guest up. What's going on?
I was asking, how long is our list of people who are not allowed on the air because they're whack jobs?
Oh, there's probably 50, 75 on there.
Yeah, and so we know who's a whack job, and so our job is not to let a whack job on, because nobody wants to hear from a whack job. And if you're a whack job, seek help. Thank you. Don't get a gun, and don't call the show.
Yes.
Steven in Florida, how are you, Steven?
Hey, Hugh, how are you?
Good.
So you probably have a better handle on this. How did we come to the point where, we're able to take away machine guns and, nobody's allowed to have a bazooka. And yet at the same time, through the 40s, 50s, 60s, into the 70s, you had rifle clubs in New York City, Philadelphia. I think that's why Chris, the senator from Connecticut, is kind of taking a little slower step, is he probably remembers, there's a cultural thing here, too. In addition to
that's why I think the best person, and thank you for the call, Steve, the best person I'm going to talk to this week, I'm going to talk to senators from different states with different cultures concerning weapons. In Maine, it is Maine is a fairly blue state, though Susan Collins always wins. Maine is a gun-owning state and always has been, because people are remote. I mean, they're living in the middle of nowhere. And Barney Fife isn't going to show up. And when he does, he's not going to be very well trained. So they protect themselves, and people know that. I mean, you drive by a farmhouse in Maine, or you're up in the woods, they've got guns. That is not going to be the case in Miami. I don't know what the culture is in Miami. I've been there exactly twice in my life. So I don't know anything about Miami culture, but I know Maine culture. And in Ohio, my classmates brought guns in their cars and went deer and rabbit shooting after school every day. And I got a taxidermist kid from my high school that I talk to every 10 years when I go back to a reunion. Guns are everywhere in Ohio, as is hunting. It's just different places. I wish people would understand. It's a big country. Patrick in Kansas. I'll bet you Kansas is a pretty gun-oriented culture.
We are definitely a gun-oriented culture, Hugh.
Yeah, I mean, it's just that there isn't anyone around for miles and miles and miles. You better have a gun.
Yeah, absolutely. I've got a friend who's got a gun range in her backyard.
Yeah.
So I'm an analyst. I work with AI. I can tell you honestly, we don't have that technology yet to identify at all a killer in advance.
That's what Mark Zuckerberg. So you're confirming wise? You're confirming what Mark told
yes.
me. How far away is it that it could be precise?
So what we do have with that technology is you can have security cameras that would spot a gun entering the area.
Oh.
And would locate that faster than an individual. And so when you go back to that hardening conversation you had last week about having echo sensors and everything else.
Yeah, I was going to bring that up.
Yep, you could have those cameras in conjunction with everything else can trigger an alarm and shut stuff down more quickly. But as far as identifying someone, even just one type of event, because there's so few and far between, there's not enough data sets to produce any credible information. You're going to end up with false positive after false positive after false positive.
Thank you for that. And you're confirming that in the 3 years since I asked Mark Zuckerberg that question, nothing has changed. Do you think eventually AI plus supercomputing, which is actually the same thing as far as my little brain understands it, will advance to where with precision, if the guidelines are set the right way, they can find the Buffalo Shooter manifesto and say, hey, red flag.
Potentially, eventually down the line, but we're nowhere near that yet.
All right. I love people who know stuff.
We have to feed all of that data together the right way and collect it, but we're still nowhere near that.
I love people who know stuff. Thank you for calling. Where are you in Kansas, by the way? Are you in Wichita or Kansas City?
No, I'm in Leavenworth.
Oh, good. I'm talking to someone who actually really knows what they're talking about. Thank you very much, Patrick. Time for me to take my second dose of relieffactor.com. If you listen to the first hour, you'll know that I got worse this weekend, not better. I did not go to the Arlington or any ceremony this weekend for the first time in years because I can't stand up for very long without that hip deal kicking in. And so I'm doubling down. You know what? When you getting old is a pain in the rear end, especially when you fall on your hip. I mean, actual pain in the rear end. But I'm doing different things to exercise that don't involve walking or running. And you need to be doing that even when you get injured doing something like walking or running. And that's relieffactor.com's job, natural anti-inflammatories. If you're like me, you can't take NSAIDs. Maybe you don't want to take NSAIDs. You don't want to take drugs. Take nature's anti-inflammatories. That's relieffactor.com. The reason I'm doubling up is because I need to. And so I'm doubling up two a day now. And $19.95 will give you a starter pack. Try it for 3 weeks. Decide for yourself. I swear by it, and I hope you try it. I'll be right back. It's Hugh Hewitt.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Prison Fellowship Academy.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt inside the Beltway. Lighting candles after a dark week is something I like to do. Prison Fellowship has been doing that sort of work for as long as it's been in existence, since my old friend Chuck Colson started it. This week we are asking you, as Prison Fellowship sponsors a education program about their Prison Fellowship Academy, to visit hughhewitt.com and hit the banner at the top. Cody Wilde joins me. He's the vice president of PF, who is in charge of these programs. Good morning, Cody. How are you?
Great to be with you, Hugh.
Are you in Virginia?
No, I'm actually in the great state of Minnesota. So, yeah.
Well, let's not go overboard.
The good state of Minnesota.
Okay, the good state. It's Minnesota cold is what we call it around here. Cody, how did you end up with PF, and how did you end up running the academy before I ask you about it?
Yeah. So I had previously served as a pastor and also as an officer in the United States Army. And then I started off working at a Minnesota prison about almost close to 8 years ago, and then I've moved around in a few different roles in the organization, and recently became vice president over the academy. So it's
now talk to our audience who's hearing for the first time. Why does an Army officer want to run a fellowship academy, and how does it work? And why does an Army officer, which I think is significant, think it's effective at training men and women on how to live their lives post-prison?
Yeah, Hugh, I think people want to be called to something greater than themselves. And so one of the cornerstone beliefs in the academy is that people have purpose and dignity, and that has to be called out. And to have people believe in them, to walk alongside them, and to train them to become good and flourishing citizens. And not only people who don't commit crimes, but people who perpetuate a process of renewal, who take responsibility for their communities and make them better.
Let's focus on that. I heard you say in that prisoners are people too. They need purpose in their lives. They need dignity in their lives. And the Academy puts it in how?
Yeah, so our mission with the Academy is to build communities and to create opportunities for men and women in prison to practice and develop values that transform themselves and others into good citizens. So like I said, our goal is always human flourishing. And so we do it through three key dimensions. Our first is a holistic curriculum. So we're going to cover everything from criminal thinking patterns to addictions and recovery to financial literacy and conflict resolution. And we are a Christian organization, and so it's all rooted in a biblical worldview, though it's open to men or to people of any faith or no religious preference at all. That's never a criteria to get in or to graduate. But what we also know, Hugh, is that each person's formational journey is often learned by being caught more than taught. And so who's facilitating that content matters tremendously. So that second pillar is coaches. So we bring in staff and volunteers who facilitate the content, and they model not what perfect looks like, but what healthy looks like, what it's like to be a little bit further along in the journey. But then the third part is a restorative community. You need people on your left and right who are going through the same thing together. And so all of our academies operate in a cohort, and participants get to be a part of one another's change journeys 24/7. And it's all geared toward human flourishing and creating good citizens.
Cody, the country's reeling after successive weeks where monsters emerged out of nowhere or out of a dark place to do horrible deeds. I'm sure you've dealt with some pretty tough people. Our scripture teaches no one is beyond redemption. What does the Academy show you?
Yeah, you know, Chuck used to quote Alexander Solzhenitsyn, and he had the line that the line between good and evil runs right down the center of every human heart. And what prison shows me is it becomes a mirror to my own soul. And those who are in prison have done seriously horrible things, okay? But that no life is beyond redemption. And so that grace is not to the exclusion of justice and accountability. They actually go together and actually necessitate one another. Yes, I've seen some horrible things and people who have done some really terrible crimes. But I've also seen some of those same individuals not only stop doing those things, but who have become change agents throughout an entire system.
A quick question I want to ask you, Cody, in light of what happened. What do the victims of crimes have to do with the Academy, if anything?
So we emphasize victim impact, that you didn't commit a crime against the state. You committed it against persons, that people were hurt, and that there isn't a way forward until you recognize that. And that goes for every crime. So, yeah, there are no victimless crimes.
And does that reach the prison population in the Academy close to 100%? Does that recognition dawn?
It does. So we our programs are really storytelling programs. So we have people talk about their life experiences as well as the crimes that they've committed. And I've seen people, as they've verbalized that story, many you can see in real time, it's the first time that they've said, I did this against this person. And you can see the facial expression and this light bulb comes on, that this wasn't, again, something that I just committed a crime. I hurt somebody.
What a powerful program. The Prison Fellowship Academy is explained at length by people like Cody over at HughHewitt.com. Please click on the banner Prison Fellowship Academy and learn about it. We don't want your money. We want your ideas and your prayers. And Cody, thank you this morning for joining me. Coming up next hour, America, Senator Tom Cotton and your phone calls ahead. Stay with us. Morning, Glory America. Bonjour. Hi, Kennedy. Hugh Hewitt live inside the Beltway on this Tuesday, May 31st in the year of our Lord, 2022. I'm taking calls this half hour. I'm going to talk with Senator Tom Cotton at the bottom of the hour in the series of senator conversations I'll be having this week with center-right and conservative senators. And I hope Chris Murphy will join me. The invitation is open to Angus King, center-left senators as well, about what, if anything, the United States Senate ought to advance to the House if they can find 60 votes in the aftermath of the massacres in Buffalo and Texas. Steve in Florida, your thoughts. Hello, Steve.
Hey, Hugh, good morning. How are you?
Good.
Hey, Hugh, good morning. How are you?
I am good, thank you.
Listen, I think before any serious gun legislation needs to be discussed, we need to find out how two unemployed adolescents was able to afford this kind of armament, this kind of arsenal. I mean, I haven't heard anything discussed about that. Do we know?
That is up there with my question list that begins with, who in the world thought it was a good idea to have a six-person police department for schools? And that just seems to me to be a decision that was taken in time at a point following a discussion that we can look at, and purchase points and the amount of weaponry and the decision process of the person who sold the weapons to an obvious, I think the monster in Texas is easily identified as something visually. I think it's more difficult for the monster in Buffalo, and maybe they disguised it. But if the sister says to the kid in Texas, as she did, no way I'm buying you a gun, then there are tells, right? And one of those tells is cost. I don't know what this stuff costs. I don't own a gun. What does it cost, Steve?
Well, two ARs, the amount of magazines he had, 1,000 rounds of ammo, you're talking well over $5,000.
Well, he was a night manager at Wendy's, so he is pulling down $1,000 a month. And he's done it for years.
Oh, see, I didn't know that.
The kid was employable. I just assume he squirreled it away. He may have stolen money from his grandmother, too. There's an altercation with his grandmother. There's no reason to shoot the grandmother unless she's not willing to give you money. I'm just guessing, right? I'm just guessing here. I don't know. But where he purchased, how do you purchase that much armament as an 18-year-old that there's no law that says the gun shop has to call the police? But maybe you do. A gun shop owner might call me and tell me. I've got a shirt-tail relative who owns one, and I've got to ask him, because I don't think he would sell things like this to this person. Right?
I agree. I mean, it should have been some type of flag, but you're right. And now you're talking about infringing on law-abiding citizens.
I'm not at this point, actually. I'm talking about what do responsible people do when they are confronted? Like, I'll take it right down. A drunk approaches you and says, it's an emergency, I got to get to the hospital. You can drive them, you can call a car, you can pay for their Uber, you can give them, but you don't give them the keys of your car, right? And you don't sell them your car. Even if the drunk offers you three times the amount of money that your car is worth, you don't sell them your car. Sometimes I am mystified by the decision, but I am also ignorant. And that doesn't make me stupid. It just makes me ill-informed about the purchase of weaponry in the United States because it's not something I do. Thank you, Steve. John in Detroit. John, is this Officer John?
This is John.
Hey, John, how are you? How's your son?
Everything is good. Except the fact that I'm against red flag laws because I don't trust the left 1 second without, they can't stand the right. They can't stand guns. They can't stand militias. They can't stand anybody who stands for anything that's right.
Now, John, let me preface this for new listeners. John is one of the most responsible callers that we have had over 20 years. He doesn't call me very often. Son served honorably in the United States military. John is a former peace officer. He trains peace officers.
No, that's not me.
Oh, I'm sorry. I got a different John. Tell me your background.
My background is I was a telemarketer.
Okay, you are not John.
I'm not that John you're talking about.
All right. Well, you sound like him. You're Detroit. You guys all sound the same.
Oh, we're from Detroit. He was from Detroit, too.
Oh, yeah. John from Detroit. Yeah, that's why you fooled me. But I'm glad you told me that. Okay, John, let me confront you as a serious person. You weren't crazy. I understand the left has abused power. I understand that we're seeing that in the Sussman trial right now. I understand that the IRS went after right-wing groups simply because they had Tea Party in their name. I do not believe the left when they deny it. I know what the left is capable of, and I know what government power is capable of. Is there no way to persuade you that states, as the authorizing agents, are different from the federal administrative state in their ability to be controlled in the authorities they are given?
Not in my state.
Well, that's absolutely true. Gretchen Whitmer has made it hard for me to make that argument, hasn't she?
She certainly has. She's locked us down, and she'd take away every gun if she could.
Every overreach by the left, I wish they would understand this. Every bit of excessive rhetoric, every bit of abuse of power, every instance of an anti-constitutional mindset alarms people who love their liberty. John, I don't have an answer for you. Michigan is a hard case. It is.
We've got to get rid of gun-free zones. I mean, what we need we got to get, we need security guards to be trained. The police are too expensive. We need security guards to be trained, and they should have AK-47s, and they should be in the schools, and there should be one entrance into the school or two. And everybody should be checked before they go in.
John, let me ask you something. Police are too expensive. There's a police department in every major city and town. The additional incremental cost of two armed officers trained and part of the police culture of that town, rotating through after 5 years in the force and in the field, as the Columbus police officer suggested last week, is about $40 billion a year, maybe 45. That's maximum. That's an incremental cost, you know, annually 45. So over 20 years, it's $1 trillion. We spent $7 trillion last year in the federal government. Why is it too cost? Why can't we have?
How are you going to get the left to vote for, this $45 billion? It'd be better for security guards with.
No. You will never persuade me of that because I know security guards, God bless them. They are not trained. If they were at the next level of ability, they would be on a force.
There's not enough of them. That's the problem. There's not enough.
We need to make it possible.
We had two police officers in every school as opposed to four or five security guards. We'd have more.
No, you're not going to get security guards. I'm not going to agree to that. I do not want people who have not gone through police academy and been trained by veteran police to be wielding weapons near children. I do not want their authoritarian streaks or their, I want them to train elsewhere. I want police. Police who understand their constitutional obligations as well as have good leadership. I don't want six-person departments.
The left will never agree to it.
Well, we'll see. We'll see. John, that you might be right. Thank you. Michael in Phoenix. What do you think, Michael?
Hey, Hugh, thank you for taking the call.
You're on. Go ahead.
Thank you. This is what my issue is right now. I'm going to say it. We've got politicians on both sides of the aisle that are not going to focus on the real problem, which is protecting our children, period. And we know the answer to do that. We know the solution. Can you please implore these people to not get bogged down with every gun control issue? Let's focus on the problem.
Amen.
These politicians, these politicians don't do that. They grandstand on both sides. We need them to focus. Let's get this done.
It's 131,000 schools. It's two armed policemen at each of them. Why can that not happen? I do not understand it.
Implore Tom Cotton and the other good people that you have on to focus on the issue. We're going to get bogged down with 9mm handguns, mental health. We're not going to.
Thank you, Michael. Amen. I said this on Fox last night. The problem set are innocent children who cannot do anything on behalf of themselves in the care of the state or of a school that's a private school. That is the problem set that can be solved. That there does not have to be a Columbine. There does not have to be a Parkland. There does not have to be a Sandy Hook. There does not have to be a Rob ever again if we will focus on that problem. Michael, thank you. Well, it's like talking to myself, so no wonder I agree with him. Don't go anywhere, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, Tom Cotton, Senator from Arkansas, coming up at the bottom of the hour. I want to get four more calls in, but I first have to remind you, AndrewandTodd.com are great sponsors of this show. Interest rates have dropped momentarily in the inflationary spiral. If you're going to buy a home or refinance a home, whether it's a first home, a second home, a vacation home, a rental home, an investment property, do it now. Do it this week. Call 888-888-1172. The 10-year Treasury dropped down over the weekend, and that means interest rates dropped down a little bit. That means AndrewandTodd.com, who are lenders with Sierra Pacific Mortgage, 888-888-1172, will be just burning up the midnight oil trying to process and lock in rates. Don't miss another momentary easing in the rapid rise of interest rates. Get in while you can. Mark in Dayton, 30 seconds, Mark.
Hey, Hugh, I think the school shootings are an effect from the three causes. The first cause is that we've lost our Judeo-Christian values. We see that with one-parent families. I think these kids consume a large amount of violence on social media, movies. It's in the music, and it's in the video games they play. And with the ease of being able to get guns, I think these school shootings are a result of those three things.
Well, I don't disagree with you, but what would you like the Senate to do?
Well, you know, how about starting with controlling the amount of violence that Hollywood puts out? How about controlling
That is the First Amendment problem. They have, some senators have heard that. And so they can register that, but that's a lot more difficult than adding police to schools. Thank you, Mark. Let me go to Dallas. Robert. Hey, Robert. Hi, Robert.
Yeah, can you hear me?
I can. Go ahead.
Yeah, so, Hugh, I think the school guard idea is great to train police officers at every school and to incorporate them within a local police force, not some independent group like apparently was the case in Uvalde. So they get the proper training and embed them within the local police force. And if people call off, then the local police force can also take care of that. What about, if not full background checks, what about waiting periods? You know, the Uvalde case had maybe, if they had waited 7 days to allow the purchase to happen, there could have been a little bit more vetting. Even some common sense vetting.
Robert, I'm not opposed to that. I will tell you, my understanding of the facts is he purchased the weapons in March. So even, and there was no red flag. Why? Because he had not been reported by anyone of appropriate authority as having a mental.
Hey, Hugh, what I think I heard was that he purchased them in May after he turned 18.
So a 7 day, I thought it was March, maybe tried in March and was unsuccessful with his sister. That might be it.
But
it wasn't within 7 days of his birthday. So do you really think waiting periods would be efficacious? I'm open to that.
I think, you know, if it has to be a little bit longer, let it be a little bit longer. Who goes into a store, the same store, twice without somebody, you know, it's like somebody going to a bar.
You're right.
And the bartender makes a common sense judgment.
I'm open to that. And by the way, that's perfectly constitutional. There's no objection to that at all in the Constitution. Thank you, Robert. J.R. in Ohio.
Hey, Hugh, go Bucks. But all of our hearts out here are completely broken. And I have three friends that are cops. Ever since my children were in elementary, intermediate, and high school, there's been what's called a resource officer, multiple ones. The cops know the kids. The kids know the cops. I sleep so well at night knowing that those guys are in there because that is the only line of defense. Anyone else that shows up is sadly for cleanup, and I'm getting sick of it.
You're right, JR, and I'm glad that Columbus does it. Let me get one more call in. Dan in Kentucky, you have a minute, Dan. Actually, 45 seconds.
Hey, good morning, Hugh. Hey, my wife and I are concealed carry permit holders. We also have the insurance in case we have to use our Second Amendment rights. Why not on a bulletproof vest? Why not require people to, if they have to buy a bulletproof vest, they must have a concealed carry permit? Because that permit in Kentucky, the state police, the local police, and FBI can check my records multiple times throughout a month, and to make sure I'm still withholding, you know, I'm not a felon, I haven't created any crimes, speeding tickets, this, that, and the other. Why not do it with bulletproof vests?
Good idea. Again, that's why I talk to people. Gun owners are actually the best people to talk to about what makes sense to control guns. Not people like me who don't have any idea. I'll be talking with Tom Cotton next. Stay tuned, America. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, live inside the Beltway on Tuesday, May 31st, 2022. I'm joined by Senator Tom Cotton. For those of you living in caves, Senator Cotton is from Arkansas. He represents Arkansas now in his seventh year, second term. Before that, he was a member of the House. Before that, he's a member of the 101st Airborne, a member of the Old Guard. He has his Ranger tab. He's familiar with weapons of war. He serves in combat. He is the father of small children. Good morning, Senator. How are you?
Good morning to you. I'm good. It's good to be back on with you.
Senator Cornyn has been appointed by Leader McConnell as the sort of Republican who will negotiate with Democrats over what, if anything, to do in the aftermath of Uvalde and Buffalo. Will you be participating in those talks directly or indirectly, and what's your initial thought on that process?
Well, Hugh, I will monitor what Senator Cornyn and others are doing. Of course, it's hard to evaluate it before the fact, and in Uvalde in particular, we are still gathering the facts to figure out exactly what happened. And I think it's important that we have those facts before we try to devise solutions to situations that may or may not have occurred. So, for instance, obviously, we thought that early last week there was a school resource officer present and that the police went in and immediately disarmed the shooter. We now know that not to be the case. So we need to get to all the facts first before we make a decision about how to address this latest mass murder. I will say that I don't think any of these terrible atrocities have a single or a simple cause behind them. And therefore, I think any call for a single or simple solution will probably fail, that it requires a careful and layered approach that addresses not just school safety, but also, the willingness of teachers and coaches and parents and others to identify troubled young boys, because these shootings are always young boys, and they're almost always troubled young boys, early, to try to help identify who may be at risk of having this kind of mental break and getting them the help they need in advance. We can also work on school safety in terms of ingress and egress points or the presence of school resource officers. But again, I don't think a single solution is going to work. I don't think there's a single cause for these mass murders.
Senator, I had a caller earlier who I agreed with because, of course, it was the position I hold, which is I do not understand why they are not armed police on school grounds when school children, especially defenseless school children at the age of, primary grades, are present. And the resource officer in Texas wasn't there. Resource officer is a misnomer. I used armed police. And in the four occasions where they have been there that Matt Vespa has written up, they effectively stopped would-be killers in parking lots because they were good and responded well. It's expensive, though. I mean, there are 131,000 K-12 public and private schools. And it's expensive to put officers there. I've had officers call the show and say, we don't want rookies and you don't want retirees. You want officers about 5 years into their tenure to do 2 years on campuses. What do you think of that general observation that generally you stop monsters with guns by armed police who are trained?
Well, I think that's generally correct. In general, the more police, the less crime. That's true at schools as well. As I said, we need to figure out exactly what happened at the elementary school in Uvalde with their police officer and why he wasn't present and why he wasn't able to neutralize that shooter from the very beginning. But in general, any place is going to be safer if it has police presence. And I think you're right, too, about the police that you want at a school. You want it to be not someone who's on his first gig or not someone who's, counting down the days until retirement. You want someone who's seasoned and experienced and has sound judgment. But again, we need to get to the facts about what happened in Uvalde, and it's something that we can incorporate into training lessons and plans. But again, as you saw there, training is only, and plans and procedures only as good as the people who are implementing them, and people make mistakes. And it's
now, Senator,
here that some people made mistakes at Uvalde.
One of the things that stands out to me, and I asked Byron York about this, is that the officer in charge, the incident commander, was the chief of the Uvalde Police School Department, of which there are six members. I don't know when someone thought it was a good idea to stand up a six-person police department. It's like Mayberry RFD. And I do not know why that happened. I suspect someone objected to the police being on the campus. I don't know. But it does seem to me that if the MAD approach, Mothers Against Drunk Driving approach, the federal funding for security at schools comes along, that it ought to be conditioned on having serious oversight of the officers in charge of school safety. A six-person police department for schools is not a smart idea. And I think I can say that conclusively at the outset. It just doesn't make any sense at all.
Yeah, I mean, Hugh, that's a state-by-state decision. My understanding is that Texas it's more common to have school district-specific police departments. I'm not aware of many, really. I'm not aware of any, I don't think, in Arkansas. There may be some here and there. But in general, we rely on city police and county sheriffs. And it's been, good cooperative relationships between school districts on the one hand and city police and county sheriff's department on the other hand. Obviously, those are two different agencies, so there's got to be some agreements about lines of authority. But the most important thing to have is tactically sound and proficient officers on the scene. Again, we'll get to the bottom of this. There were, by reports I've seen, 19 officers present. And I'm confident that either the FBI or the Texas Department of Public Safety is doing a thorough after-action review and interviewing every one of those officers. So we'll know exactly what happened. But it appears obvious that they made serious mistakes in not neutralizing the shooter quickly. I mean, there may have been mistakes between the communications of the 911 dispatchers and the police on site as well, because it's clear that we have multiple calls from inside the classroom. The children were still alive, and the shooter was still present. I think at some point there were even a few shots fired that the police officers certainly would have heard, since 9/11 dispatchers fired. And this is very common to what we learned in the Army, which is when you're under fire, especially, for instance, if you're under a sniper fire, then the first thing you have to do is neutralize the shooter. Even if your battle buddy to your right or left is shot, that means that by definition you and everyone else are still within range of that shooter. So you have to neutralize the shooter even before you tend to the wounded or evacuate everyone else to safety. That was true what we learned in the Army. It's true whenever you have, a deranged shooter at a school or at a shopping market or anywhere else. The first step the police take has to be to neutralize the shooter.
Senator, I'd like to know your thoughts. When the president starts talking about 9mm, which is, I think, 56% of handguns owned in the United States, I said on Fox News Special Report last night, that sets the conversation backwards. There is no appetite for a ban on handguns in the United States. None. Zero. What's your reaction to the president's ramblings about 9mm?
Well, Hugh, I think it shows that the president is confused about what happened, and he's just confused about firearms as well. This is a common feature I've seen in Washington over the years, is the people most enthusiastic about regulating guns know the least about guns. We had the nominee for the ATF last week ahead of us. This is a man who ran for attorney general in Ohio and called for an assault weapons ban. And I asked him to define an assault weapon, and he couldn't do it. And the reason he couldn't do it, Hugh, is that there really is no such thing as an assault weapon. There's a rifle, there's a shotgun, there's a pistol of various calibers. But an assault weapon is a category of weapons. It's designed by mostly cosmetic features that are labeled by lawyers and lobbyists and politicians in Washington. Yet people still talk about that as if it is a definable category of weapon that could be regulated by law. Or they go out and talk about things like 9mm as opposed to, 22 or 5.56 or 7.62. Some of them seem like not even know the difference between a rifle and a shotgun at various times. Before they start trying to infringe upon the Second Amendment rights of law-abiding citizens, you'd expect them to at least familiarize themselves with the most basic facts about firearms.
Now, I had a parent call earlier who pretty much spoke for me as a grandparent. And you're a young parent. I'm a young grandparent. We do not want our children growing up in schools that are target. And he asked me to urge every senator, and I will, to stay focused on protecting innocent children in schools. That does require the investigation you've talked about. But I've seen so many comments that have immediately moved on to other things. Do you think the Senate working group can hold focus at least on a problem set that is defined and manageable, at least in a conversation? Because if it wanders all over the place, there won't even be a conclusion on the specific issue of children in fourth grade being protected.
It seems at least that's the focus right now, Hugh. And like I said, I think that's would be a better focus and a spawning debate about banning entire categories of firearms when most people talking about banning them don't even know what they really are. And support for that among the American people is quite low.
Now, Senator, with 2 minutes left, I want to switch to Ukraine. President Biden yesterday ruled out sending rockets that could hit Russia. That's another stupid comment because, you know, any rocket can hit Russia depending on where you are on the Ukraine border. And I go back to former President Trump used to say he didn't want to tell our enemies what we were going to do or not do. I kind of think that what used to be laughed at is now actually a pretty good response for this situation. What do you think?
Well, Hugh, they're continuing this foolish lawyerly distinction about offensive and defensive weapons. I mean, call me crazy, Hugh, but Russia invaded Ukraine. Ukraine is defending its own territory. I think any weapon is inherently defensive. And Ukraine needs longer-range artillery and rocket systems to make sure that it can reach the Russian troops that are on Ukrainian soil. But this is part of a pattern, you're right, going back to the fall of Joe Biden continuing to say what we will not do. You know, he said we will never put troops into Ukraine. I don't think we should do that either. I don't think we should simplify Vladimir Putin's calculation by telling him that, though. In fact, it's so silly, Hugh, now that we have not yet put the U.S. Marines back at our embassy in Kyiv. Our diplomats are there. The office staff are there. Yet they won't put Marines to defend the embassy, as they do, Hugh, in downtown Moscow. Because Joe Biden announced we wouldn't have troops in Ukraine, and now you've got everybody in the White House chasing like a cat chasing their tail, figuring how they're going to let the Marines do their job to defend the front gates of the embassy while respecting the president's announcement that we're not going to put troops into Ukraine. I would contrast that to you with, say, what Ronald Reagan did in Afghanistan. In today's dollar, he spent billions supporting the Afghans fighting back against Russia when they invaded that country. But he almost never talked about it in public, and he certainly never ruled anything in or out, even though he never seriously considered putting troops into Afghanistan, because he never wanted to do anything that would simplify Russia's war planning then, the way Joe Biden continues to simplify Putin's planning now.
Well, and fully said. Senator Tom Cotton, thank you. The first of many senators I'll be talking to this week, and an experienced and wise head on these issues. Thank you, Senator Tom Cotton. Reminding everyone, twice today at TakenReliefFactor.com, our great sponsor. I take it twice on days when I'm trying to bounce back, and I am, and so I do, and so I believe in it, and I want you to try it too. Whether or not you've done a face plant, even if you've just got aches and pains from a good Peloton workout, try Nature's Anti-Inflammatory Pharmacy. Icarin and Curcumin, Resveratrol, and Omega come in every package of ReliefFactor.com. And the three-week starter pack is $19.95, and it does work, and that's why I doubled. I take one every day, but when I've done something stupid, which occurs with some regularity given my coordination, I double down. And so I encourage you, if you're not doubling down, to at least give it a shot. ReliefFactor.com costs $19.95 to get a three-week starter pack. Go there. When I come back, Charlie Dombek joins me. But I do want to assure you, we're going to talk investments after this segment in an inflationary environment, that I will be back soliciting more conversations from senators and your calls all week long as the Senate Working Group begins. Stay tuned. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Key City Capital.
Welcome back, America. I'm standing by for Charlie Dombek of KeyCityCapital.com. I encourage you to go to KeyCityCapital.com/Hugh. Getting ready to make an investment with them, a very significant one. But Charlie is MIA, or I was MIA, or we just mixed up our signals. Let me play for you last night the special report panel on Fox News. Mike Emanuel setting in for Brett Baer. And I'm joined by Jeff Mason and Ben Domenech, cut number 10.
With that, let's bring in our panel, Ben Domenech, editor of thetransom.com and host of the Ben Domenech podcast on Fox News Radio, Jeff Mason, White House correspondent for Reuters, and syndicated radio host Hugh Hewitt. Gentlemen, welcome.
Okay. Thanks, Mike.
So, Ben, your thoughts looking at the Zoom call tomorrow between bipartisan senators?
Look, I should concede at the beginning that I worked for John Cornyn for a number of years. I have enormous respect for him, but I don't really believe that there's going to be a path forward when it comes to finding some sort of significant progress when it comes to gun control that the left in America would really like to see. Certainly, I think that there's a lot of people who, you know, in response to Uvalde, are clamoring for something to happen. We see this happen whenever one of these terrible events befalls the country. But unfortunately, in this case, as in so many, there are very few steps that can be taken when it comes to governmental policy or law that would actually prevent these types of atrocities from taking place. Now, one thing that I do think is possible is that you could see the, you know, push for additional red flag type of opportunities, mm-hmm. you know, potentially, you know, some other small steps, but you're not going to actually see anything happen that would prevent this type of specific occurrence from taking place in the future. And unfortunately for Americans, that's something that I think they just have to come to grips with. You cannot flag people who do not, you know, spark the type of legal reactions that you could see in the case of mental health or other disorders.
It sounds like there were a lot of heartbreaking breakdowns there on the ground in Uvalde, and there's investigations looking into that. Hugh, what are your expectations as lawmakers get together to discuss a possible path forward?
Well, I want to agree and disagree with Ben, Mike. I think John Cornyn is the perfect person, having served on the state Supreme Court of Texas. I think he also ought to consult with Rick Scott, who is governor of Florida. He's now senator from Florida. Passed legislation in the Sunshine State in the aftermath of the Parkland massacre. But I do think there is a path forward if expectations center on how do we protect innocent children like those in Uvalde against monsters like those that came. And that usually means armed police who are well trained on the campus before the monster arrives. And I think if they follow the model from MAD back in the days when the drinking age went to 21, federal dollars in exchange for state legislation, those federal dollars for the police on the campuses would, I think, get some states to study seriously the Florida model and others. But I've got to say, President Biden took us all backwards today by bringing 9mm handguns into the discussion, because there is simply no consensus anywhere for denying people the right to own handguns. It doesn't exist.
Jeff, outdoors with the birds chirping on a beautiful day here in Washington. Your thoughts, what are the expectations at the White House?
Well, I think number one, you saw this reflected in President Biden's comments today, that they see some momentum, or at least they see an opportunity to do something here. And whether it's as far as the left would like to go, I think Ben is spot on in saying that that's certainly not going to happen. But I think this president would be happy to see something. And whether it's on background checks, or, I mean, one of the things that has been raised is changing the age limit for or the age level for when you can buy an automatic weapon. I think all of those things are things that they're going to look at and consider.
All right, let's see if we can get around the horn. Stop
right there. We went on to talk about Ukraine.
Ukrainians want bigger.
Nobody in the United States can legally buy an automatic weapon. I got comments on Twitter after Jeff's comments. Why didn't you correct them? Look, we had 5.5 minutes to do two subjects. If I corrected everyone who made a mistake about, and just a misstatement, he probably meant semi-automatic weapons. Jeff's no dummy. No one can buy an automatic weapon in the United States. It's not legal. And so they're all semi-automatics. And I do not want to try and describe the difference between them, because I'm ignorant about the difference between them, but I know there is a difference between them. And I got lots of comments about, why didn't you step in? And here, the simple answer is, the president simply stepped on it yesterday by talking about 9mm handguns. And Jeff didn't want to say that. And until we all realize that the president is not, is shuffling through a deck that, of really old cards and canards and dealing with an 8-track tape player in an age of supercomputing, we're not going to move this forward. If you're counting on the president to come up with a solution, forget it. There is Chris Coons, there is Angus King, there is Chris Murphy on the left, there is John Cornyn and Susan Collins and Rick Scott on the right, and they can reason together, and maybe something will come out of it that is persuasive to both sides. We will see. I will continue to pursue that all this week, because it was the worst Memorial Day since 2002's Memorial Day after 9/11, and I think people are in a frame of mind of serious of purpose, and they're fed up with silliness and stupidity, and they're just not going to put up with it. They might not agree, but they're just going to dismiss people who are silly or stupid, I hope. I'm Hugh Hewitt. I'll be back tomorrow on the next Hugh Hewitt Show. Thank you, Dwayne. Thank you, Adam.